are gathered here to talk about a rather distinct archaeological and cultural phenomena, which is represented by the different kinds of megalithic complexes found throughout the South Asian subcontinent, ranging in time from the 2nd millennium BCE to the present day. But in today's discussion, we are generally talking about only the prehistoric to early historic examples. In many cases, we must say that these megalithic complexes have also been found to be associated with the dawning of the first Iron Age in this subcontinent. Now, for this discussion, we have here Chirantuni Dash, who is teaching at St. Xavier's College, and Nibabori Banerjee, who is teaching at Netaji Nagar College. Now, you see, the term megalith comes from two Greek words, megas meaning big and lithos meaning stone. Now, this is actually a blanket term which is denoting different kinds of monuments built by prehistoric people all over the ancient world, some of the earliest examples coming from Ireland and England. And the only common thing that link these megalithic complexes is the fact that these have been fashioned from large, roughly dressed slabs of stone. And generally speaking, these monuments house human burials. These structures have been classified according to the forms that they have into different kinds, like orthostats, menhirs, cairns, dolmens, cists, portal tombs, gallery graves, passage graves or barrows. Okay, these are the huge array of megalithic structures. And archaeologically speaking, in most cases, we find that the megalithic complex are associated with some kind of prehistoric culture. But that is not to say that they represent a distinct homogeneous cultural complex. The megaliths are simply representing a typical burial practice which had emerged among different cultures in different regions at different points of times throughout the world. Now, so far as the Indian subcontinent is concerned, we have a concentration of megalithic complexes in the peninsular region, starting from the Aravalli and Vindhyan Ridge across to the Deccan Plateau and beyond into the southern India. But there is a very important complex of megaliths in the northwestern part of the South Asian subcontinent also. And interestingly enough, we have very recent examples of practicing megalithic burial types among some recent tribes in Chotanagpur and Assam. And these often provide us very good scope for drawing ethnological analysis, even for the prehistoric examples.
Ma'am, what are the different categories of megaliths that have generally been found in South Asia?
You see, generally we find three types of megaliths. Number one would be the chamber tombs, number two would be the non-chamber tombs, and the third would be some megaliths not associated with any kind of burial practices. Now, the chamber tombs are nothing but 2 to 4 vertical stone slabs or orthostats standing up, which were capped by a horizontal stone. Now, this kind of chamber tombs are again of 3 different types. The chamber tombs which are absolutely below the ground are called cists. The chamber tombs which are absolutely above the ground are called dolmens. And there are certain chamber tombs which are slightly above the ground and slightly below the ground. These are called dolmenoid cists. And among the non-chamber tombs, we have 3 different types. See, we have the pit burials, then urn burials, and then the sarcophagus. Now, in case of pit burials, again, we have 4 different types. In case of pits which are encircled by large stones, these are called stone circles. Then the second type are pits which is piled up by a lot of stones placed like caps, and these are called cairns. In some cases, we have both the circle of stones as well as the pile up of used stone on the top. These are called cairn stone circles. And in certain cases, we have a pit which is just identified by a freestanding huge slab of stone, which is a menhir.
And ma'am, the urn burials have the funerary remains placed in a globular vessel, which is called urn. While the sarcophagus burials contain a terracotta trough, often with legs and a lid, the burials in rock cut chambers are also counted among the megalithic burials. Sometimes the megaliths are not connected with burials. Some of them are simple arrangements of large stone in geometric pattern. Their precise significance cannot be determined. Perhaps they signified memorials for the dead. These settlements, which can be associated with burials, are so rare that assessments prove to be even more difficult. The megalith complex in India were found in Vindhyan region, the Deccan region and southern India. The megaliths in Vindhyan region sprouted in pre-Iron Chalcolithic context.
Yes.
The megalith sites in peninsular India, on the other hand, are associated with iron. Some of them date back to 1300 BC, while the others were as late as the early centuries of CE.
Exactly.
Ma'am, tell us about the megaliths in the northwest.
See, in the northwest of the South Asian subcontinent, especially in the region which is known as Swat, which lies between Chitral and Peshawar on both sides of the Hindu Kush, we have come across a very interesting megalithic complex which goes by the name of Gandhar Grave Culture. This name has been coined by the very noted archaeologist A.H. Dani. Now, excavations by Dani and Georgios Takul along the Swat and Dir rivers revealed the presence of large number of cemeteries. And according to both the excavators, it seems that the cultural assemblages and the pottery and the burial type signify a homogeneous unit. And the excavations were conducted by Dani at Swat and by Stakul at Birkot, Khundai, Loebar, etc. And later on, other excavations pointed out that this cultural complex had extended beyond this particular region of Swat into the Vale of Peshawar and into the Indus region. Okay, this is a very interesting complex.
Ma'am, what was the connection between these sites and introduction of iron in the subcontinent?
You see, according to a number of scholars, the Gandhar Grave Complex actually is one of the four principal cultures which document the first use of iron in the South Asian subcontinent. And of course, as you know, that the cultural complex actually extended over a very long period of time, and it is only towards the end that we find the appearance of iron, and that coincides with the period 3 of A.H. Dani and period 7 of Georgios Takul. But the date is the same. It lies around 400 to 300 BC. Along this time, we therefore find that the iron had made its first appearance in this part of the subcontinent. There are certain interesting evidences in the form of spearheads, nails and other things found from different sites. But a very interesting piece has been located at Timargarha, which is a very important site, and that consists of a snaffle bit coming from the cheek piece of a horse's harness. And this has been correlated to some Eurasian finds by Carl Jetmer. It seems that Eurasian finds were related to horse ornaments also, and the dates belong to about 6th to 7th millennium BCE, and these were probably connected with the Indo-Europeans. It may seem to have been connected with this particular Gandhar Grave Complex in the context of South Asian subcontinent too.
Ma'am, what is the nature of megalithic complexes in Vindhyan region?
Especially in the southeastern part of the Uttar Pradesh, we find that there is a concentration of megalithic sites, especially in the regions of Allahabad, Banda, Mirzapur and Varanasi. These examples were first discovered by Alexander Cunningham in 1861, and later on they were extensively explored by A.C. Carlyle in 1883, who also identified them as barrows especially. Now, most of the examples are actually cairns and stone circles, and the region is very interesting. The ecologically speaking, this is actually the meeting place of the Ganga Plains into the northern part of the foothills of the Vindhyan Range. and the natural resources for building the megaliths also come from the same area. So ecologically, this is an important niche for the megalithic culture to grow. One thing has to be considered that this the Vindhyan complex of megaliths are pre-iron. They do not belong to the Iron Age at all. Three different geographical zones have been identified here. The first zone actually is located in the Chandraprabha and Karmanasa river valleys, which comprises the Chakya subdivision in the Varanasi district. And in this particular area, we generally find cairns covering the grave pits, etc. And one of the major sites is Kakoria. And another very interesting fact is that the Vindhyan complexes are also related to habitation sites. For example, at Kakoria, we do have a habitation site associated with the megalithic structures.
Now, ma'am, group 2 is centered around the Chunar region and the northern part of the Mirzapur district, and the geographical zone actually continuing from the Chakia region, and around 400 graves were identified there. And at Panchbahani in Jungle Mahal, 5 grave pits have been discovered, and 3 major types were identified, like the cairns.
Right.
Cairns with slab cysts or chambers, and cairns with enclosing stone circles.
Mm-hmm.
And group 3 of megalithic complex comprised of circular cairns are located near a number of sites near the Rewa Chachai region, and Kotia is one of the primary sites,
right.
And it represents mm-hmm. pre-iron megalithic culture.
Mm-hmm.
At Kotia, the graves contain few human skeleton, but it was rather associated with
animal
burials.
Yes.
And Kotia has a date between 800 BC to 300 BC.
Another thing to note is that, as we have seen, the Vindhya region complexes, megaliths, were belonging to a pre-Iron Age date. But when we come down to Maharashtra, we find that, generally speaking, these are associated with the Iron Age. Archaeological evidence reveals that use of iron first dawned in India around about the 1000 BCE times. Of course, for regular use of iron in productive processes, we have the date of around 600 BCE. Now, the Maharashtra megalith sites, which are also known as Vidarbha megalith sites, are clearly associated with the general use of iron. We have such evidences, extensive evidence for iron use in different sites coming from this area. Another very important thing about the Vidarbha sites is that they are related to habitations, and extensive habitations, in fact. For example, at Takalghat, which is an important site, we have an habitation area of about 22,500 square meters. And at Naikund, the area extends to about 100,000 square meters.
Important sites include Takalghat Kapa, Naikund, Ranjala, Mahurchari, etc. And Naikund has an early date ranging between 800 BC to 420 BC and 785 BC to 410 BC. These sites were full-fledged agricultural settlement sites, which can be deduced from the presence of barley, rice,
yes,
and lentil grains on the house floors. A large number of copper and iron artifacts have been found in the site, including ladles, nails, chisels, blades, axes, fish hooks, weapon, etc. And it has been suggested that iron was smelted locally. The remains of a workshop with a furnace and a terracotta cylindrical pipe is also found from the site of Naikund. Ma'am, what can we generally say about the megalithic complex in the Vidarbha region?
You see, the most important thing is that so far as demography and economy is concerned, The Vidarbha complex had really revealed a lot of advancement. Demography is indicated by the large number of burials at one site in the Vidarbha complexes. And there was also quite a lot of evidence for agricultural practices. We also have evidence in the form of hoe and sickles among the iron implements. And also there was a larger use of cattle as indicated by the faunal assemblage. So it seems that they had been practicing sedentarism as well as, you know, farming, and habitation sites, association with habitation sites also indicate this. Now, there was a complementary development of crafts, handicrafts. This is also indicated, as you said, by the kind of metallurgical works that was evident from these, some of these sites. And this is also wonderfully brought out by a steel chisel which has been recovered from the site of Mahurjari, for example. An analysis of this particular steel chisel has been reported by Deshpande, Mohanty and Shinde, which shows that it was formed by stages of carburization from a full-blown iron ingot. The techniques of hardening, quenching and tempering were utilized to form into a steel. So it shows that a kind of achievement, metallurgical achievement had taken place among the people here. And that would also indicate that these people were engaged in this craft activity full time. So it seems that there was both a development of an agricultural economy which was sustaining a non-productive economy too. I mean, non-primary producing economy too.
Ma'am, the material ingredients associated with the sites comprised of diagnostic black and red pottery along with red slipped ware and the burnished black ware in a wide variety of shapes for daily use, storage and other ritualistic purposes. Apart from copper and iron implements, there are traces of flourishing bead industry.
So you see, there was a lot of craft activities that is coming up. So Vidarbha megalith actually represents a kind of a new stage of economy. Nipapuri Chirantani, can you give us a general profile about the South Indian megaliths, for example, names of sites, the regions from where they have been found, etc.?
Ma'am, in South India, the earliest iron objects appear in connection with megaliths. At most of the sites, the earlier Neolithic phase overlaps with the megalithic cultural levels. In Tamil Nadu, the megalith sites are found in Amritamangalam, Adi Channalur and other places.
And in Kerala, the megalithic sites are centered around Pulimattu, Tengakkal, then Machar and Mangaru, etc. While Machar has an early date ranging from 2nd century BCE to 2nd century CE, Mangaru has a time bracket from 1000 to 100 BCE.
In Karnataka, we have the major sites at Brahmagiri, Maski, Hallur and Hanamsagar. And in Andhra Pradesh, we have the sites of Nagarjanikonda, Kadambapur, Gallapalli, and the other site is Amaravati. Now, these have also had some connections with the early historical sequences in certain places. You know, the typical structure associated with the megaliths in case of the South India are very distinct. We have from Kerala and Karnataka the distinctive types of topicals and codicals. These are all urn burials. In case of topical, the urn is placed in a pit which is capped by low circular convex stone slab, capstone. And in case of a codical, urn is placed within a chamber built of four vertical slabs or orthosteps which is capped by a very large hemispherical capstone. So these are the two types that we have for burials in case of South India, especially in Kerala and Karnataka. What kind of general evidence do we get about the economic conditions of the South Indian megalithic cultures?
In South India, the megalithic sites emerged as flourishing agricultural communities supplemented by large-scale hunting, fishing and stock breeding. The subsistence pattern of the people at these sites can be deduced to some extent from the paintings and the figurines. For example, at Marayur and Attala in Kerala and at different sites in Karnataka, the hunting scenes are depicted.
Yes.
Bones of wild animals as well as of domesticated animals like cow, sheep and dog appear in profusion, corroborating these pictorial
Absolutely.
Evidences.
A few sites have yielded vegetable remains which throw some light on the crop pattern in a very general way. The principal crops range from different types of pulses to millets to cereals. And though green gram, horse gram and ragi appear to be the major crops, still from Coorg and Kapa in Karnataka, rice husk can be found definitely. And also in a site called Kunnathur in Tamil Nadu, the rice grains were found. Another very striking feature of the South Indian megalithic sites is the recovery of large number of grinding stones and pestles.
Yes, and this all this evidence taken together would show that there was a definite intensification of the agricultural economy. And in especially in recent explorations, people have found a large number of megalithic sites in Tamil Nadu, especially located near rain-fed tanks, irrigation tanks. Apart from this, we do have evidence for handicrafts, especially the metal use. We have copper as well as sprinkling of gold, and that is no wonder because many of these sites are located near the gold-bearing veins in the Dharwad region and other places. Apart from that, iron working is very, very much evident from the South Indian megalithic contexts. For example, the first very well-defined iron equipment that was found in the context of the first Iron Age in the subcontinent had come from Halur in Karnataka. Mm-hmm. So that is very interesting. And then again, we have evidence for the iron objects from Machad, which reveals that there was a high degree of perfection that had been reached with respect to smelting process, because the analysis has shown that all the iron objects had very little trace of impurity. And that shows an advancement in pyrotechnology as well as a knowledge of metal, that is iron. And also we have some other evidences from Payampalli. We have evidence, for example, at Naikun we had an evidence for working of iron at the spot. And again, in the case of South Indian megalithic context, we have similar evidence from Payampalli in Tamil Nadu. Finally, we come to the northeastern megalithic complexes, and this is very unique and very interesting. Because here we find that the megalithic culture is not only recently extinct but still living in some cases. And most of the sites are located between the valley of Assam to the plains of Sylhet. And the general states where we find this kind of megalithic practices comprise of Assam, Arunachal, Manipur, Mizoram and Meghalaya and Tripura. And we have a number of such cultures. They are being reported day by day, and we have some ethnological evidence reported by different scholars from that area too.
And ma'am, the largest concentration of sites is found around the Khasia and Jayantia hills, with important sites like Letkor, Unisto, Nartiang, Nongkrem, etc. A sprinkling of such sites may also be found in the Angami area of Nagaland, the Naga inhabited areas of Manipur and the Mikir and Kachar hills.
Yes.
The modes of disposal of the dead vary according to regional and local customs. The Khasia hills yield ample evidence for elaborate stone structures, mostly alignments and main hills, dolmens being comparatively rare. The urn, sometimes containing the ash, is placed in little circular cells with flat tops. The main hills were generally erected in the memory of the ancestors.
Okay. Our survey of the megalithic complexes from different parts of the South Asian subcontinent reveals that they belong to different types of historical junctures and display a colorful array of different types of cultural customs and practices and also cultural assemblages. The point from where we can really identify the megaliths are where the cultures had actually given rise to certain specific belief systems with regard to their burial practices. And this may have been associated with some kind of changes in social organizations as well as their belief systems, which is reflected in this kind of burial practices. Now, Our survey shows that in many cases, these megalithic complexes belong to a very early time associated with pre-Iron Age complexes, even sometimes may be associated with nomadic pastoralism. Now, in these cases, we find that the megalithic assemblages are not associated with any kind of habitations. In those cases, we find that probably the urge for this kind of megaliths, building up of these megaliths, had cropped up from among the pastoral nomadic cultures. In other cases, we find that megalithic complexes have been related to habitation sites and also to advanced material culture. And in those cases, it seems that there was a kind of an advancement or complex social organizations which indicated a different kind of burial practice, whereby the burials were sent out of the habitation area to a distinctly demarcated space. Now, there is also indication of great degree of organization of community effort for building these megalithic structures. So that also talks about certain kinds of social organization. Taken in all, we can say that these megaliths actually represent different historical realities from different junctures of history in the subcontinent, but they all have certain contribution to the development of the regional cultural patterns.